massage. So, chapter 22. David at the cave of Adullam. Adullam? Or Adullam? David departed from there and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And when his brothers and all his father's house heard it, they went down there to see him. And everyone who was in distress and everyone who was in debt and everyone who was in bitter soul gathered to him. And he became commander over them. And there were with him about 400 men. So now he's building his own little kingdom. And David went from there to Mizpah of Moab. He said to the king of Moab, "Please let my father and my mother stay with you, till I know what God will do for you." And he left them with the king of Moab, and they stayed with him all the time that David was in the stronghold. Then the prophet of Gad said to David, "Do not remain in the stronghold. Depart and go into the land of Judah." So David departed and went into the forest of Hereth. Saul killed the priest of Nob. Now Saul heard that David was discovered, and the men who were with him. Saul was sitting at Gibeah, under the tamarisk tree on the height, with a spear in his hand, and all his servants were standing about him. And Saul said to his servants, who stood about him, "Hear now, people of Benjamin, will the son of Jesse give every one of you fields and vineyards? Will he make you commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds? That all of you have conspired against me. No one discloses to me when my son makes a covenant with the son of Jesse. None of you is sorry for me or discloses to me that my son has stirred up my servant against me to lie in wait as at this day. Then answered Doeg the Edomite, who stood by the servants of Saul. "I saw the son of Jesse come to Nob, to Ahimelech, the son of Ahitub. And he inquired of the Lord for him and gave him provisions and gave him the sword of Goliath the Philistine." So, what's that man's name? Doeg. Snitch. Then the king sent to summon Ahimelech the priest and the son of Ahitub and all his father's house, the priests who were at Nob, none of them came to the king. And Saul said, "Hear now, son of Ahitub." And he answered, "Here I am, my lord." And Saul said, "Why have you conspired against me, you and the son of Jesse, and that you have given him the bread, you have given him bread and a sword, and have inquired of God for him, so that he has risen against me to lie in wait at this day?" Then Ahimelech answered the king, "And who among all your servants is so faithful as David, who is the king's son-in-law, and captain over your bodyguard, and honor in your house? Is today the first time that I have inquired of God for him? No, let not the king impute anything to his servant, or to all the house of my father. For your servants have known nothing of all this, much or little. And the king said, "You shall surely die anyway, you and all your father's house." So Saul curses Ahimelech. And the king said to the guard who stood about him, "Turn and kill the priest of the Lord." This man is wild. The Lord didn't give him the commandment to do none of this, because their hand also is with David, and they knew that he fled and did not disclose it to me. But the servants of the king would not put their hand and strike the priest of the Lord. Then King said to Doeg, "You try to distract the priest, but he too cowardice to do so. He probably not though." And Doeg the Edomite turned and struck down the priest, and he killed on the day 85 persons. Jesus. 85 persons who wore the linen ephod, and Noah of the city of priests. He put the sword, both men and women, child and infant, ox, donkey, sheep, and he put the sword. And he put to the sword. He put to the sword. Basically, he put all those to the sword. He killed all those people. But one of the sons of Ahimelech, the sons of Ahitub, named Abithar, escaped and fled after David. And Abithar told David that Saul had killed the priest of the Lord. And David said to Abiathar, "I knew that one day when Doeg, the Edomite, was there, that he would surely tell Saul." He like, I knew he was going to snitch. "I have occasioned the death of all the persons of your father's house. Stay with me, do not be afraid, for he who seeks my life seeks your life. With me, you shall be in safekeeping." Chapter 23. David saved the city of Keilah. Now they told David, "Behold, the Philistines are fighting against Keilah and are robbing the threshing floors. Therefore, David inquired of the Lord, 'Shall I go and attack the Philistines?' And the Lord said to David, 'Go and attack the Philistines and save Keilah.' But David's men said to him, 'Oh, so the Lord told David to go and attack.'" Okay, wait, not David told him. When we told David, behold, the Philistines are against Keilah. Okay. But David's men said to him, "Behold, we are afraid here in Judah. How much more than we go to Keilah, against the armies of the Philistines?" Then David inquired of the Lord again. And the Lord answered him, "Arise, go down to Keilah, for I will give the Philistines into your hand." And David and his men went to Keilah, fought the Philistines and brought away the livestock and struck them with a great blow. So David saved the inhabitants of Keilah. I think it's Keilah. When Abiathar, the son of Ahimelech, had fled to David in Keilah, he had come down with an ephod in his hand. Now it was told Saul that David had came to Keilah. And Saul said, "God has given him into my hand, for he has shut himself in by entering a town that has gates and bars." And Saul summoned all the people to war to go down to Keilah to besiege David and his men. David knew that Saul was plotting harm against him. And he said to Abiathar, the priest, "Bring the ephod here." Then David said, "O Lord, God of Israel, your servant has surely heard that Saul seeks to come to Keilah to destroy the city on my account. Will the men of Keilah surrender me into his hand? Will Saul come down as your servant has heard? O Lord, the God of Israel, please tell your servant, and the Lord said, he will come down." The Lord like, he will come. Then David said, "Will the men of Keilah surrender me and my men into the hand of Saul?" And the Lord said, "They will surrender you." Then David and his men, who were about 600, arose and departed from Keilah. What's interesting is, he maybe could have asked the Lord for instructions. So like, my thing is, instead of asking the Lord, okay, is this going to happen, is that going to happen? He could have asked the Lord, "What do you want me to do? What should I do?" Because we obviously know that the Lord wants David to be the next king. So I feel like he wasted questions in a way. Not that the Lord is a genie and we only have three questions, but he could have asked the Lord, what do you want me to do? Especially since he hears the Lord so clearly. Because the Lord is answering questions very straightforward. Then David and his men, or about 600, arose and departed from Keilah. And they went wherever they could go. When Saul was told that David had escaped Keilah, he gave up the expedition. And David made him strongholds in the wilderness, in the hill country of the wilderness of Ziph. And Saul saw him every day, Jesus. But God did not give him into his hand. And David lied, I mean Saul lied, talking about the Lord gave him into my hand. No, he did not. So that was a straight lie, which we all knew that. Saul pursues David. David saw that Saul had come out to seek his life. David was in the wilderness of Zeph at Horesh. And Jonathan, Saul's son, rose and went to David at Horesh and strengthened his hand in God. And he said to him, "Do not fear, for the hand of Saul, my father, shall not find you. You shall be king over Israel, and I shall be next to you. Saul, my father, also knows this." And the two of them made a covenant before the Lord, and David remained at Horesh, and Jonathan went home. Ooh, this is getting good. I just read the next title. Okay. Then the Ziphites went up to Saul at Gibeah, saying, "Is not David hiding among us in the strongholds of Horesh, from the hill of Hachilah, which is south of Jeshimon? Now come down, O king, according to all your heart's desires to come down, and our part shall be to surrender him into the king's hand." And Saul said, "May you be blessed by the Lord, for you have had compassion on me. Go, make yet more sure." Okay. Go make yet more sure. I think maybe he's saying like, go make sure. I don't know. No one see the place where his foot is yet, and who has seen him there? For it is told to me that he is very cunning. See therefore and take note of all the lurking places where he hides, and come back to me with sure information. Then I will go with you, and if he is in the land, I will search him. I will search him out among all the hundreds of Judah. And they rose and went to Ziph ahead. Now David and his men were in the wilderness of Moab, in Arabah, to the south of Jeshimon. And Saul and his men went to seek him. And David was told, so he went down to the rock and lived in the wilderness of Maon. And when Saul heard that, he pursued after David in the wilderness of Moab. Saul went into the south side of the mountain, and David and his men went to the other side of the mountain. And David was hurrying to get away from Saul, and Saul and his men were closing in on David and his men to capture them. A messenger came to Saul, saying, "Hurry and come, for the Philistines have made a raid against the land." So Saul is so busy pursuing David that he left Israel, what's what I'm looking for attack, open for attack. Like, he's so jealous and so fixated on David. He's not even doing his job as the king. It's like he's digging himself into a deeper hole each time. And after David, it went against the Philistines. Therefore, the place was called the Rock of Escape. And David went up from there and lived in the strongholds of En-Gedi. But who keeps telling on David? David spared Saul's life. Chapter 24, this is our last chapter. When Saul returned from following the Philistine, he was told, "Behold, David is in the wilderness of Engedi." Then Saul took 3,000 men out of Israel and went to seek David, chosen men. He went to seek David and his men from the wall posts of rocks. And he came to the sheepfolds by the way, where there was a cave, and Saul went in to relieve himself. Now David and his men were sitting in the innermost parts of the cave. And then the man of David said to him, "Here's the day in which the Lord has said to you, 'Behold, I will give you your enemy into your hand, and you shall do to him as you see good.'" So now the Lord is like, do what you want to do. Do what you think is good. Then David arose and stealthily cut off a corner of Saul's robe. And afterward, David's heart struck him because he had cut off a corner of his robe. He said to his men, "The Lord forbid that I do this thing to my Lord, to Saul, the Lord's anointed, to put out my hand against him, seeing he's the Lord's anointed." David still loyal, even after he was trying to kill him. So David persuaded his men with these words that it, and did not permit them to attack Saul. And Saul rose up and left the cave and went on his way. Afterward, David also arose and went out of the cave and called after Samuel, and he called after Saul, "My lord the king." And when Saul looked behind him, David bowed with his face to the earth and paid homage. And David said to Saul, "Why do you listen to the words of the man who said, 'Behold, David seeks your harm'? Behold, this day your eyes have seen how the Lord gave you today into my hand into the cave, and some told me to kill you, but I spared you. I said, 'I will not put out my hand against my Lord, but he is the Lord's anointed.' See, the corner of your robe is in my hand, for by the fact that I cut off the corner of your robe and did not kill you, you may know and see that there is no wrong or treason in my hands." David is so loyal. He's like, "I could have killed you." As a proverb of the ancient says, out of the wicked comes wickedness. "But my hand shall not be against you. After whom has the king of the Israel come out? After whom did you pursue? After a dead dog? After a flea? May the Lord therefore be judge and give sentence between me and you. And see to it, and plead my cause, and deliver me from your hand." Wow, that's a man right there. As soon as David had finished speaking these words to Saul said, "Is this your voice, my son David?" And Saul lifted up his voice and wept. He said to David, "You are more righteous than I." Yeah. Because David knows he would have killed Saul. Saul knows that he would have killed David. So he's showing them how to be an upright man. Then Saul said, "For you have repaid me good, whereas I have repaid you evil. And you have declared this day that you have dealt well with me, and that you did not kill me when the Lord put me into your hands. For if a man finds his enemy, he will let him... will he let him go away safe? So may the Lord reward you with good for what you have done to me this day. And now behold, I know that you shall surely be king." "And that the kingdom of Israel shall be established in your hand. Swear to me therefore, by the Lord, that you will not cut off my offspring after me, and that you will not destroy my name out of my father's house." David swore to Saul. Then Saul went home, But David and his men went up to the stronghold. What does that mean? David and his men went up to the stronghold. And I think that was something important, but I don't know. So, that is the Lord's reading for today. What I got from it, what stood out to me the most was, David had Saul in his hands. He could have killed him right then and there. But it would make him no better than any other man. Because there was a point in time where, where Saul was anointed. And even though the Lord's Spirit left him, he still was a child of God. He still was anointed. So that makes me wonder, can the anointing be you? I know the Spirit can. That's what, because that's what they said happened. But even when you could do your enemies wrong, just don't do it. Because the Lord told him, you got the right to do whatever you want. And he still didn't do what he wanted. He just did what was right. I guess that is what he wanted. But wow, we go through this much of the Bible already. That's a big chunk. But there's so much. Even if I go back and read all this again, it's going to be a billion things that I didn't see before. So, Father Lord, thank you so much for, you know, I was going to find a reason to be inconsistent, but no. I'm still consistent, I'm still here. And I understand the importance of reading my word every day. So, Lord, just give me a spirit to do this every day for the rest of my life. Even if it's not 5 chapters, even if it's 3 or 1 chapter every day. Lord, give me the strength. I will finish 5 chapters until this is done, I'll say, when it's time to do it again. I hear 5:31. But yeah. Thank you for getting me here safely. Thank you. In Jesus' name that I pray. Oh, and thank you for this good book. This book is cool. I'll do a review on it later. But in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.